morning, church.
It's a little bit cold outside, but here we enjoy the warmth of God's love. David said, I am glad when they said unto me, let's come to the house of the Lord. There's no better place to be in a Sabbath day, the Sabbath of the Lord, to be in the place of the Lord in His presence. We're so happy that the Lord brought us here for a reason. It's not us, it's His Spirit guiding us to be here for a purpose. He has a message for you and me. And we are delighted that we have guests. And today, we have potluck, but we have a special place for our guests. Because we want to let you know, you are welcome in our church. And if you come and stay with us, that will be a great blessing for us and for you too. So stay, and we will serve you the best we can. And after that, we have lots of meetings. We have the deacons, the deaconesses. We have the communication, Sabbath school. It's because this is the time that we can talk of how we can serve the Lord more effectively. And we started our study last Sabbath, and we will continue it this afternoon at 3 o'clock. I invite you. We will be talking about one of the most basic and fundamental beliefs of the church about who Jesus is. Because we love Him, we serve Him, we worship Him, we need to have a deeper understanding who He is, so that we will learn to be drawn closer and closer to Him. And so the health ministry will have the 5 o'clock sundown. So our Sabbath is full, so don't go anywhere else. This is the place where God will bless us. So for our church service today, it is sponsored, if you notice. Mostly they don't consider themselves young adults anymore. And they are the next generation who will take over the leadership of the church. They are now leading. But of course, those with white hairs, like me, will soon exceed. And this next generation will be our leaders. And the theme they selected is leadership. There are times when we find some challenges in looking for leaders. If you've been with nominating committees in the past, we spent days asking, Lord, send us leaders. And today we will be talking about how God will show us qualifications or requirements of somebody whom He chooses to be a leader. So let's bow our heads as we start opening the Word of the Lord. Father God, we've done our singing, we've done our praying. All we want is to listen to Your voice, Lord. Use me as Your mouthpiece. Speak through me, Lord. May they see Jesus instructing them through His Word, that we may understand Your will, that all of us may sense that this message is for us, because He wants to be a leader in our own sphere of influence, at home, at school, at work, here in church, in our society, because you need individuals whom you can entrust the responsibility of caring for young ones. Thank you for hearing us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One of the most interesting characters in the New Testament, especially with the disciples of Jesus, is Peter. His personality is amazing. I like him because I can see, especially in his weakness, I can look at him and see in a mirror much of my weaknesses. And so let's study about how Jesus patiently molded him for him to be one of the major pillars of the Christian church. A day before Christ's crucifixion, the disciples were talking, who among us is the greatest? You remember? They look at each other. And they thought that the three inner circle of Jesus, who were there? Peter, James, and John. They were so confident. You heard about how the mother of James and John approached Jesus so that they will be given some favorite spot in his leadership. While they were talking among themselves, who is the greatest? Jesus showed them how to be a servant through the ordinance of humility. And after the Lord's Supper, still, these thoughts were being entertained in their minds, and Jesus predicted his crucifixion, his death. And he said, tonight, something will happen, and you will be scattered. And all of you will leave me. Who was the one who answered Jesus first? Peter. And he said, to show that he is the greatest among the disciples, he said, they may leave you, all of them, but I will be staying with you. Even unto death, I'm willing to lay my life for you, Lord. And then Jesus said, if you look at Matthew 26, Luke 22, and John 13, it talks about how Jesus said, Peter, don't be so confident. Before the rooster crows tonight, you will deny me three times. But Jesus told him, Peter, when you will be reconciled back to me, I have a mission for you. We'll talk about that. And so we know what happened. We know that before the rooster crows that night or that morning, Peter denied him how many times? Three times. But after that, he saw in the eyes of Jesus, a special gaze at him that melted his heart, and he repented. But even though he repented of what he did, when Christ was arrested and was crucified, where was Peter? Who alone was left with Jesus? John, with Mary, the mother of Jesus. Peter, with all other disciples, they were all hiding somewhere because they were fearing for their lives. If they nail our leader, who will be next? It will be you. It will be me. Run for our lives. when Jesus was buried, they were thinking, what happened? But the first day came, and there was a news that Jesus was alive. What do you think Peter was thinking? I denied him 3 times. I disappointed him. I repented. If he is alive, there were mixed emotions, feelings with Peter. How will I face him? What will be the words he will utter to me? When he learned that Jesus was alive, he was the first one who came running. But the tomb was empty. The third time they met Jesus on the shore was this scene that we are going to talk about. Some of the disciples met in the shore. They were talking, what is next? We've been with the master for 3.5 years. We were trained. We were talking. We were listening to him. How about now? What will be next? So Peter told them, okay, I'm going fishing. Are you going with me? I'm going to Sebastian Inlet. And the other disciples said, okay, we'll go with you. And you know the story. They've been out the whole night, nothing. And it was almost dawn. They were coming back. And they saw somebody there in the shore doing something. There's smoke. They can see the smoke from afar. And then the voice came and said, did you have any catch? And they said, we toiled all night. We got nothing. And the stranger said, cast your net on the right side. And what happened? They obeyed. And they were not fishing the way most of you fish with line. They got this big nets. And when they were pulling, they were so surprised. And they remembered that the first time they encountered Jesus was the same situation. And so John said, it's the Lord. Who came first running? Peter. While the other disciples were still caring for the net and trying to figure out how they can bring their catch to the shore, Peter was already running to meet Jesus. This is Peter. And when he went near Jesus, he saw Jesus was already preparing breakfast. He was nervous on what Jesus would say. He was expecting that, Peter, what happened? Did you not promise me? But he did not hear any word of confrontation, of any accusation. All Jesus said was, bring some of your catch. We'll continue to make ihaw or to cook this fish. Instead of scolding, instead of confrontation, Jesus prepared a meal for them. What a beautiful example of love. Remember where Peter denied Jesus? Where was he? He was warming himself on a fire, right? Because it was a cold night. While he was warming himself before a fire, somebody recognized him. Seems like you're one of those followers of Jesus. And so that's the first time he said, no, never. It was before the fire. And Jesus, when he reinstalled Peter to the ministry, it was also before the fire. It was a fire of rejection, but now this is a fire of reinstallation, of reconciliation, a fire of acceptance, a fire of relationship. But when they finished eating, he talked with Peter. Maybe he placed his hand on Peter, and Peter said, "This is it. What will he say to me?" And he said, "Simon," that was his first name before he became Peter, "do you love me?" Husbands, do you always hear that question from your wife? Do you really love me? Are they in doubt? Do they think you don't love them? No, they just want to hear it again. It's music to their ears. It's because they don't hear those words very often. When we were courting our wives, we always say that. But after a while, we just take it for granted. You know, I come home every night. I give you my salary. I fix the door. I bring this. I do this. Is it not enough for you to know that I love you? But our wives just want to hear it again and again. Jesus was not asking it because he does not know. He knows our hearts. He knows our minds. He asked it so that we can freely express it before him. There are lots of sermons you heard about how Peter denied Jesus three times, and so he has to ask him three times. But the point in our study this morning is Jesus wanted to bring back Peter into leadership. Jesus was emphasizing to Peter that the basic foundation of service in leadership is love. You may serve because you want to be known. You may serve because you feel like I'm the most qualified person. Why don't they elect me? I'm the most gifted. You may have many reasons for service, but to Jesus, the reason why we serve is our love for him. He loved us so much, and in response, we love him. And the reason why we give our lives, our service, our time, our energy, our talents, it's because of our love to him. Peter realized how Jesus loved him. Despite of all his failures, despite of his denial of Jesus, despite of what he did to Jesus, his arms were still open to accept him. Oh, brothers and sisters, if we know how God loves us, if we fully realize how he cares for us, then that's the only time we can say, in return, Lord, in response, I'm giving myself for service. And when we learn to love the Lord through our experiences, then we can honestly say, Lord, my service to you is not because I will get anything. Any praise, any recognition, any plaque of appreciation. That's not the reason why I'm serving you. I'm serving you because you love me so much. If I look back at my experiences, when I was down, when I rejected you, you were still there. I deserve punishment. I deserved rejection. But you were there with loving acceptance. Peter, he was so proud. He was so self-confident. He thought he can do all things. But the Lord has allowed him to go through different humiliating experiences so that at the end he can show, Peter, it's not who you are. It's not what you can do. It's not what you can accomplish. It's because I love you. It's because I have plans for you. No matter what you do, my love for you is unconditional. How many among you here have disappointed the Lord in the past? How many among you here promised something and yet not deliver on your promise? You said at the beginning of the year, I will do this. I will, Lord, just give me. And I will do such a thing. But when time comes, we forget all our promises. There were occasions when, despite of what he did to us, instead of God, we choose our own selves. We choose our own pleasures. We choose our own conveniences. And when we come before the Lord will just embrace us with his arms and say, my son, my daughter, do you truly love me? We always say, Lord, we sing, I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. In moments like this, we love you, Lord. And right after that, what happens? We turn our back and don't do the things that God wants us to do. Despite of your experiences, despite of my experience, despite of what happened to Peter, Jesus is here saying, if you know, if you recall the degree of my love for you, my question is, do you respond through your love? Brothers and sisters, if the motivation of your accepting leadership position is because you are shy or embarrassed to say no, it will not last. If the reason why you are an elder or a deacon or a leader of a department is because you just don't want to disappoint the nominating committee, or you want to show that you can do something, you want to show that the past leader of this department has not done anything, I will show them. Now that I'm here, it will be a different day. If the motivation of our service is something except love, it will not last. Because there will be times when we will be tested. There will be times when we will be challenged. There will be times when we will be so low and down as if we are alone serving the Lord. But if it is the love for God that motivates us, we will keep on going. We will keep on going because God's love keeps on going too. And then Jesus, the reason why I entitled our study, On Your Mark, Get Set, Go, in service and in leadership, you will be on your mark when you learn to love the Lord. When what's reigning in your heart is the love for Him, whether somebody is watching or not, whether somebody is praising you or not, whether someone is criticizing or saying things against you, because you are on your mark, God's love is in your heart, then you will be set for the next requirement or the next words of Jesus. When He said yes 3 times, or even for the first time, what was the response of the Lord? If you love me, feed my lambs. There are those who try to play on, why lambs, why sheep, first why feed, why take care? That will not be our emphasis this morning. When we love the Lord, He will not say, give me your tithe and offerings. Yes, it's an expression of God's love, of our love to the Lord. That's great. But to leaders, because to some, it's easy to give money. To some, it's easy to donate. I don't have time. I'm so busy. Can I just donate? Oh, we welcome that, you know. Those of you cannot go to our attend our work be tomorrow and you want to donate food, we welcome that. But what is the most important mission of the Lord for us if we love Him? He said, feed my lamb. He did not even say, if you love me, kneel and worship me. That's good. That's understood. But our love to the Lord is not always manifested in the way we serve Him directly. Remember, He said, I was hungry and you did not feed me. I was in prison and you did not visit me. I was naked and you didn't clothe me. And the people said, we're always with you almost every day. We've been following you every day. When were you hungry? How can you be hungry when you are the one who produces bread for 5,000 people? How will you be in prison when... And so people were thinking, what is this saying? But Jesus said, if you are doing this to the least of my brethren, you're doing it to me. Our love to the Lord is not that always we sing praises. Yes, singing praises is good. Singing in the choir is remarkable. Leading in singing is good. But God is saying, one of the best ways you can show your love to me is when you love my children. You know how it is when you have children and grandchildren? When you are growing old, you don't think a lot much about yourself, right? When you have your birthdays, you're no longer that excited. Who will give me this? Who will give me that? But when it's the birthday of your son or daughter or your granddaughter or grandson, I appreciate those of you who gave gifts for my birthday or appreciation. This is the second suit that I received for minister's appreciation. I appreciate it. But when many of you gave gifts to my granddaughter, oh, my heart was filled with so much joy. Those of you grandparents, you know that. Brother Dale, Sister Christine, I know you have your granddaughter there.
the best way to show our love is when we love whom they love. And they are hurt whenever you do something that hurts what they love, whom they love. And so Jesus is saying, if you truly love me, I have lots of children. I have lots of sheep or lambs who need to be taken care of. Brothers and sisters, leaders, church members, everyone, God is saying, the reason why I blessed you, the reason why I called you, it's not just for yourself. Remember the sermon of Pastor Reyes? We are blessed to be a blessing. When you are blessed with a gift of singing, is that for you? Oh, you can go to the shower and sing all day long. Alone by yourself. That's good, you sing, but that's not for you. It's for others to be blessed. If you are blessed with the skill to cook, is that for you? Oh, that will be a danger. You keep on cooking and eating. The reason why God gave you the skill to cook is because there are those whom He wants you to share the food. Not just your friends. If you are my friend, then I'll make you a cake. It's for those lambs and sheep of God. If you are gifted with preaching, what will you do with that? Is that for yourself? It's not just for your spouse. It's for others to know more about Jesus. And so he was saying, Peter, if you truly love me, think of the people I love. Think of those without food. Feed them. Think of those who need some education. Take care of my sheep. If they are being taken away by someone else, protect them. If they are being taken advantage of, protect them. If they need to grow, feed them. So brothers and sisters, leadership is not just giving commands. Leadership is not just giving orders. Leadership is not just leading meetings. Leadership is service to God's people. And God's lambs may be the children in our family. God's lambs may be the children in our church. God's lambs may be our church members, our neighbors. So Jesus said, if you love me, take care of my sheep. Feed. Instead of scolding them. Oh, there are pulpits that are well known for scolding. I hope I'm not known for scolding members. You do this, you read, and it's about you. No, the pulpit is about feeding, strengthening, sharing the Word of God so that we will grow in our spiritual experience with the Lord. You may not be doing it here at the front. You may be not be doing it in your classes. You may be doing it in your homes. Feed God's lambs. It may be in your neighborhood. Be the instrument of the Lord in lifting the poverty, lifting people from their hurts, helping those whom God died for because God love them so much. So, if we love the Lord, we are already on the mark. And when you are ready to serve, then you're already set. But the Lord said, Peter, let's read John chapter 21. Go
Go to your Bibles. Verse 18, John 21, verse 18. Most assuredly, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and walked where you wished. But when you were old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. What is this, Lord? And he explained, he spoke, signifying by what death he would glorify God. In short, God was saying, when you were younger, you determined what you will do to yourself. But in your last ministry, you will be helpless. People will do something that you cannot control. And what was Jesus talking about to Peter? It says, Jesus was predicting that he will be killed at the end of his ministry. Did he not promise the Lord? He said, everybody may be scattered and leave you. I will be with you. And Jesus is saying, Peter, you failed me when they arrested me and they crucified me. This is now the time to fulfill your promise. You said, you're willing to lay down your life for me? Lay it down while serving my people. Brothers and sisters, when we are leaders, when we serve the Lord, you are not promised prosperity. You are not promised that you will always be healthy. You are not promised that everything will be okay. I was listening to these preachers in television. They're always promising, once you are faithful to the Lord, your sickness will be healed. Your needs will be granted. Everything, your pocketbooks, or your pocketbooks, your bank books, your ATM, your wallets will be full. Have you heard about preachings like that? Oh, how good it is if it will always be true. Yes, the Lord says, I will bless you. But it should not be the motivation for leaders, and it should not be the motivation for service. Because who among the disciples who gave entirely their lives became well-known because they become rich? They become rich in God's love. Who among them did not suffer illness or persecution? No. If by giving yourself to the Lord, you are thinking, Lord, I'm doing this, what can I get out of it? Remember Ellen White and James White? They gave their lives, everything to the Lord for service to the Lord. And yet, what happened to one of their children? At an early age, he died of sickness. If I remember it right, even James White died of what sickness? Tuberculosis. So when you are serving the Lord, when you are in a leadership position, don't think that God's favor will always be for you. When you are a leader, you will be criticized. When you are a leader, some of your co-leaders will leave you. When you are serving, there will be times when you feel like, Lord, is this not a mistake? I have accepted the position, or I have accepted this role in the church. How come after I studied the lesson for the whole week, preparing, even coming up with illustrations, they come late and they don't even know the lesson? And Sabbath after Sabbath, it seems like we're not going somewhere. As leaders, you'll be confronted with so many challenges. As we serve the Lord, even as parents, you said, I have given the best education for my children. I have sent them to
piano lesson, swimming, all of this. What happens now? They don't even remember me. They only call when they need money. That's the price of leadership. You don't do things for your children, for the children of the Lord, in order for you to receive back. It's good when you are remembered. Someone say thank you, someone appreciates, but that's not always guaranteed. Even Apostle Paul, when he was asking the Lord, Lord, take this thorn in the flesh, what was the answer of Jesus or answer of the Lord? No, I will not take it out. Why? Because in your weakness, that's when you will become strong. So don't even ever think that because some of your illness is not being healed by the Lord, that God is punishing you. No, it's not always the case. When we go through tough times, when we go through sufferings, it's not because we have been mistaken in our decision to serve the Lord. Yes, it happens to me many times when I said, Lord, how come? So many promises here. We claim it for someone else. Some are blessed. How about me, Lord? And the Lord says, count your blessings instead of those that you miss. Yes, when we serve the Lord, be ready even to give your life. Oh, Peter was so brave. When Jesus was about to be arrested, what did he do? He took his sword. Do you think he was aiming at the ear? No. Maybe he was aiming at the neck or at the head, but he missed it. And Jesus was saying, Christianity, following me, is not killing somebody. It's willingness to be killed in my name. How can we be ready to be killed in his name when even simple things we cannot do for him these days? And yet we sing, I love you, Lord. Brothers and sisters, Jesus is telling us, I've shown you my love. Where's the love in return? You can love me by caring for those people that I care a lot. Even if it means your life, even if it means you will suffer. Remember how I suffered for you? Did I go back and say, it's worthless, Father? These people don't appreciate it? No. He went through all the plans. Why? Because of his love for you and me. And if we love him, no matter what happens, we do it for his sake. Last part. So he was already set. He was on his mark because he loved the Lord. He was already set because he was willing to serve the Lord by fitting and even unto death. But something happened. As he looked back, whom did he see? Let's go to the Bible. Then Peter, turning around, saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following, who also had leaned on his breast all that supper, and said, Lord, who is the one who will betray you? Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, but Lord, what about this man? Do you understand the situation? Lord, you're telling me if I truly love you, I will serve you and your people, but at the end I will die. It's a little bit tough, Lord. And he saw John. How about him, Lord? Is that only for me? How about him? Oh, Peter was saying, it will be for everybody. But because he was saying, I'm going to die. If I'm going to die because of service, it should not only be me. How about other disciples? Do you understand what he's talking about? Oh, when I was new in the ministry, I was single. I was on my prime years, 23 years old, if I remember. I was assigned in one of the remotest district in Palawan. And I have seven churches. Seven. I might say seven and yet I say this. And one of my farthest church in Riotuba, you have to take the boat, ride the boat going there. But if it's windy, there's no trip for the boat, I have to hike. I start hiking, walking, before sunrise. I arrive at my destination after sunset, walking. There are times when there's no big trail. I cross the river, waiting for somebody with a canoe. It was tough. While I was walking, I have my backpack with me. My mosquito net is there, my blanket, my change clothes, my Bible, my lesson quarterly. My supply is there. While I'm walking alone, I remember my other classmates who were in Manila. They were riding motorcycles. They were in a jeepney. They were having their... I was thinking, Lord, why did you place me here? The more I think about my miserable situation, I come to the point when I was already crying. I pity myself too much. Why? Comparing myself with others. Have I done wrong, Lord, that you are punishing me? Remember Martha and Mary? Martha keeps on cooking. Looks at her sister. Where's my sister? Oh, she was just listening there, comfortably enjoying. And so instead of complaining to Mary, your turn to cook. She said, Jesus, can you tell my sister? This is not fair. Don't you realize, my dear brothers and sisters, when we are serving the Lord, we are not just thinking about what we're doing. We always compare ourselves to others. As an elder, I'm doing this. How about the other elders? Where are they? I keep on cleaning the church. Where are you? While I'm serving, there's always the tendency to say, Lord, why only me? Oh, the Lord has said, you are not ready yet if you have that kind of attitude. What was the answer of the Lord? He said, if I will do that, what is that to you? If I will allow him to live until I come, what's your problem? You know what Jesus is trying to say? Peter, focus on your ministry. Focus on the mission that I give you. Just mind the work that I gave you. If I bless them, that's my priority, that's my prerogative. Oh, sometimes we think, Lord, why are you blessing them more than me? Lord, have I not given everything? How come? Others have enjoyed their lives, but me? Oh, brothers and sisters, that's not what God wants us to think when we are leaders and we are serving. If we love Him, just do what He wants us to do, and Jesus will take care of the rest. You may say, How about him? You may not know the trials that he is going through. Sometimes you are quick to judge. When we are attending prayer meetings, sometimes the tendency is, where are those that are not attending? And we say things that only few are now ready for the Lord's return. We feel like we are more righteous and we are holier than the rest. The Lord says, you don't know what you're talking about. The Lord said, be ready. Be on your mark, loving the Lord. Get set by willing to serve, even unto death. And don't always complain about other people. Go. And Jesus did not only say go. It says, get your on your mark, get set. And Jesus said, follow me. He did not only say, go, let's go. I will be with you. Just follow me. Oh, brothers and sisters, if we know that we love him because of his great love for us, we serve people that he cares for, regardless of what happens to us, without complaining and without seeing other people, the Lord will say, just follow me. And I will be the one who will grant you what you what I know is best for you. There was a couple. They were a wealthy couple somewhere in Boston. The lady was a socialite. You know how she dressed class with all those, what do you call? Everything that makes her beautiful. Accessories, and they were engaged to be married. But this lady realized that God has a call for her somewhere in Africa. She was a nurse, according to the story. And she tried to explain to her fiancé that she is being called to the Lord for a mission service. The husband has a different interest. And it ended up breaking their engagement. So she went and left her fiancé and served as a missionary nurse in one of the remotest villages. After many years, this boyfriend of her happened to visit that place. And he asked his guide, bring me to that clinic where my former fiancé is working. And so when he arrived there, surely he saw. I'll read this story so that I will get the whole emphasis. It says, years later, on a business trip to the country in which she served, he made his way to the small hospital where she worked as a missionary nurse. Directed to the second floor, he saw her down on her knees cleaning the floor. He slowly approached and saw that she was cleaning up after a patient who had gotten sick. He called her name. She stood, faced him, smiled, wiped her hands on her soiled apron, and then greeted him. Hi, John. In astonishment at her lowly act, John said, Mary, there's not much enough money in the world to make me do what you're doing. Even I will be paid the biggest money, I cannot do what you're doing. The response of the lady is, with glow in her face, she said, John, there's not enough money in the world to make me do it either. But there are things you will do for Jesus that you will not do just for money. We are leaders. We are servant, not because of what we get. It's because of our response to the Lord. In closing, I want to call on those leaders of the church. If you feel like you want to recommit yourself to God, whether you're elected or not, you feel like God has called you to serve, I want you to come forward and we will recommit our service, our lives to the Lord, no matter what happens. And as we sing, "Make Me a Servant," can you come forward? Only if you feel like the Lord has been speaking to you. Elected officers of the church, but you feel like the Lord is calling you for a mission in your home, at work, or anywhere else. You're saying, "Lord, I want to love you because you love me so much. I'm giving myself to you for service." You may stand or you may come and join forward as we have our prayer of recommitment to the Lord. Another song. Repeat the song. So much. You lay down your life for us. You receive all the beatings, humiliation, because you're thinking of us. Father, you called us to be your disciples. You called us to be your followers. Lord, in recognition of your love to us, when you say, "My son, do you love me?" Lord, in chorus we will say, "Yes, Lord, we love you." Not just in words, Lord. We love you in our hearts, in our minds, and we're willing to prove it through our actions. Lord, we want to be your servants, to lift those who are weak. The young lambs, the sheep, your people, Lord, who are hungering, help us to feed them. Those that are discouraged, help us to strengthen them. Those that are lonely, help us to visit and lift their spirit up. Lord, we will do it without complaint, come what may. Lord, we cannot do it on our own strength. We cannot do it because we're weak, but we count on your strength. We count on your spirit. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And so, Father, we commit ourselves once more, not because we are able, but because you promised, I will be with you, just follow me. We will follow you, Lord, wherever you go, for your sake. Amen. Amen. You may now sit.